We arrive out of many singular rooms, walking over the branching streets. We come to be assured that brothers and sisters around us to restore their images on our eyes. We enlarge our voices in common speaking and singing. We try again that solitude found in the midst of those who with us seek their hidden reckonings. Our eyes reclaim the remembered faces, their voices stir the surrounding air. The warmth of their hands assures us and the gladness of our spoken names. This is the reason of cities, of homes, of assemblies in the house of worship. If you could all join me in the unison chalice reading, please. It's in your order of service. That dream shall have a name after all, and it will not be vengeful, but wealthy with love and compassion and knowledge, and it will rise in this heart, which is our America. We kindle our chalice for the dreams of our nation's heart.
I have a story for us this morning, because something rather momentous actually happened on the 3rd of July that we don't always talk about. On the 3rd of July, or maybe it was on the night of the 4th, but on the 3rd of July, members of the General Congress of the United States agreed upon the language of the Declaration of Independence. And they couldn't actually vote on it till the next day, till enough people were there, but agreements and wordsmithing happened really on the anniversary of this date. Now, we have a special interest in that for two reasons. One, because we're all Americans and in the United States, but two, because some of the folks who were in the thick of the arguments and debates around drafting that Declaration of Independence were our ancestors. They were Congregational and Unitarian people. I want to tell you about just two of them in what I would use as my children's story, if there were any young children here. This is a lovely book. It is called The Signers, 56 Stories Behind the Declaration of Independence. It's by Dennis Brindle Frandon, and it's illustrated. And I just want to tell you a little bit about one of the Unitarians. And this is a Unitarian whose name is familiar. His name was John Adams. John Adams is one of two signers of the Declaration of Independence who went on to become the president of the new nation. He was born in Braintree, Massachusetts, near Boston. He went to Harvard. He taught for a year. He later claimed, "We have new speakers, did you notice? I'm going to have to get used to them here." Excuse me. He discovered he didn't like teaching. But he said he learned everything he learned about human nature from his students that one year. And then he began the study of law. After he was an attorney, he met Abigail Smith, who he called Miss Adorable, all of their lives together. He and Miss Adorable, which is a kind of a funny misnomer, because we know Abigail Adams through her correspondence with her husband, and she was far more than simply adorable. She was very bright and instrumental in a lot of the ways that he thought. John Adams was the cousin to Samuel Adams, and Samuel Adams was a rabble-rouser for this idea of independence, and he's the one who recruited his cousin John to the cause. John served in the Continental Congress. By 1775, he wrote in one of his letters, "The die is cast, sink or swim, live or die, survive or perish with my country is my unalterable determination." Now, John Adams was one of the drafters of the Declaration of Independence. He was part of a committee with Thomas Jefferson and Ben Franklin and a couple of others. And in one of his letters, he records how it came to be that Jefferson was the primary author. And so this is the dialogue that I wanted to share with you. Thomas Jefferson says, "You should do it." John Adams says, "Oh no." "Well, why won't you do it?" says Jefferson. "You ought to do it." And Adams says, "Oh no, I'm not going to do it." And Jefferson says, "Why not?" He said, "Well, enough reasons." "Well, what are they?" "Well, you're a Virginian, and someone from Virginia ought to write this document and ought to appear to be the head of this business. But reason second, I'm obnoxious and suspected and very unpopular, and you are very much otherwise. Reason third, you can write 10 times better than I can. Well, if you're decided, I will do as well as I can." Now, how many of you have heard that exact conversation in a committee here at church? Yeah. Our roots go back a long, long way. So, Adams was a Congregationalist Unitarian. This was back before the Unitarians and the Congregational churches had split. But he was already beginning to articulate Unitarian sympathies. And Thomas Jefferson was a deist with strong Unitarian sympathies. And they had a long correspondence for many, many years. They actually died on the same day, July 4, 1826, 50 years after the adoption of the Declaration of Independence. And the story is that John Adams, who was 90 at the time, the story is that his final words are, "Thomas Jefferson survives," not knowing that Jefferson had died the same day. A little earlier that day, or the day before, a community member visited Adams, and he asked for a toast to be offered at the 4th of July celebration. And the toast that, here's what Adams said. He says, "I will give you a toast. I give you independence forever." And the visitor replied, "Do you have anything to add to that?" Hoping for something longer. And Adams simply said, "Not a word. Not a word. Independence forever." So, I have the pleasure of introducing Rob Thompson.
Santa Fe Envision is in this very special niche of a social arena that's badly underserved. These are families that are just above the homeless situation. They're not completely integrated into the community, and the role of Envision is to do that. We mentor at this point 8 families who are stuck in this situation. We've supported this organization before with First Sunday giving and also by holding cooking classes for families in Envision. So Envision is not a stranger to us. And I'm a liaison. I'm not on the board.
Oh, I thought you were.
There's not. I don't know of a board, actually, but I'm on the advisory committee, and I've been with them since their beginning. They have recently started a program for their families to supply food boxes of fresh vegetables and for the families. Families in this situation typically do not feed themselves very well from the standard federal food assistance program. And this program is designed to do that. It provides the families with a box of food every week. These are produce foods, from local farms, and also with assistance in how to cook it. The boxes are paid for by Envision. And they cost $10 for each box per week. But we have funding for the current program for the current families. But we expect to expand the family as a whole. The program as a whole in the fall, and we need help your help to help us pay for these food boxes for the additional families in the fall. Now, let me also mention to you that this food program is not just for Envision families. Envision pays for the boxes, but Gail uses...
I pay for my home.
There's a program called MOGRO that this is part of. And so if you would be interested, if you have a family of kids that that eat you out of house and home, and are looking for good food at a more than reasonable price, this is a way to do that.
So one of the things Rob didn't tell you is that one of the reasons Envision is looking to expand the program come fall is because we are hoping that Santa Fe is going to be identified as a resettlement site for Syrian refugees coming to this part of the country. And one of the ways we will do that is by adopting some of those families as our Envision families, that because we already have the structures in place. So we're working on it. It's gone to the state government, and we are waiting to hear back if New Mexico will be approved. I'll keep you posted. Let us enter a time of quiet and contemplation. I invite you to close your eyes if that is comfortable for you, to take a deep breath and to feel your body relax. As we calm ourselves and find our centers, let your thoughts drift and feel your heart soften and open. Breathe and let yourself be held in the affectionate regard of this community. As we sit together in the quiet, I would offer you these words adapted from Nelson Mandela. We understand it still that there is no easy road to freedom. We know it well, that none of us acting alone can achieve success. We must, therefore, act together for reconciliation, for community building, for the birth of a new world. Let there be justice for all people. Let there be peace. Let there be work and bread, vegetables and water and salt for everyone. Let each know that for each, the body, the mind, and the soul have all been freed to fulfill themselves. Let that freedom reign. Amen, and blessed be. So, we have two readings this morning, a very short one and a longer one.
The first reading is Roger Wilkins, quoted from Forest Church in the American Creed. The Declaration of Independence, for all the ambiguity around it, constitutes the Big Bang in the physics of freedom and equality in America. That is our big Declaration of Independence. And I'm not going to read the whole thing. When in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them a decent respect to the opinion of mankind, requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation. We hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. To secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed, that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or abolish it, and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them seem most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Prudence, indeed, will dictate that governments long established should not be changed for light and transient causes, and according to all experience hath shown that mankind are more disposed to suffer while evils are sufferable than to right themselves by abolishing the forms to which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations pursuing invariably from the object evinces a design to reduce them under the despotism, it is their right, it is their duty to throw off such government and to provide new guards for their future security. Such has been the patient sufferance of these colonies, and such is now the necessity which constrains them to alter their former systems of government. The history of the present King of Britain is a history of repeated injuries and usurpations, all having in direct object the establishment of an absolute tyranny over these states. To prove this, let the facts be submitted to a candid world. Now we'll skip to the end. We, therefore, the representatives of the United States of America, in General Congress, assembled, appealing to the Supreme Judge of the world for the rectitude of our intentions, do, in the name and by the authority of the good people of these colonies, solemnly publish and declare that these United Colonies and the rights ought to be free and independent states, that they are absolved from all allegiance to the British Crown, and that all political connection between them and the state of Great Britain is and ought to be totally dissolved, and that as free and independent states, they have full power to levy war, conclude peace, contract alliances, establish commerce, and do all other acts and things which independent states may of right do. And for the support of this declaration, with the firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor.
So you probably have a clue about why we're reading that in church. In a place where we have the separation of church and state. All right. So, one of the traumas of my youth, right up there with long division, was learning how to drive. And I think the only thing that kept me going in the face of a driver's ed teacher who teased that blondes should not even be allowed to ride in the front seat of a car, say nothing about drive, was the awareness that everyone else in my family, my mom, my dad, all of my aunts and uncles, my cousins, my grandmother, all of them had learned both long division and how to drive. And therefore, I was quite certain that I would be able to do those things too, eventually. I'm not certain, but I think that this knowledge that other people who are like you have accomplished a thing, may explain the widespread attraction of genealogy in our midst. You see, if you know what your forebears did, you have a sense of what you in turn are capable of, what you can expect of yourself, and maybe what is expected of you. I think this is true for us in families. It's also true for us in nations and cities and faith communities. Now, last Friday night, I took Isaac and Zoe to the Museum of Natural History, or the History Museum here down at the Palace of the Governors, and we visited the print shop. And if you read the paper, you will know that what they were doing in the print shop on Friday was setting and then printing copies of the broadside version of the Declaration of Independence. So we watched as they printed this one, and then we got to take it with us, and we listened while they told us a little bit about the process, and then we joined a group of, about as big as this one, maybe 90 or 100 people, and we read the whole thing out loud, in unison, including the piece in the middle that we didn't read today, which is called The Indictments, where they say all the things that the king has done wrong. And it was an interesting homeschool civics lesson, and it was also interesting, I think, in its own right. Because whether or not you are one of those who traces their lineage all the way back to one of the 56 men who signed this document, this document is actually a part of our patrimony. It's part of our inheritance as Americans. It's also part of our inheritance as Unitarian Universalists. It is the work, in part, of our religious ancestors, as well as of our civic ancestors. And that, because of that, it both empowers us and charges us to live up to the vision that it casts. So there were 56 men who signed the Declaration of Independence back in 1776, and 32 of them were actually Episcopalians. And another 12 were Presbyterians, and 13 of them were Congregationalist Protestants. One was Catholic. And then there were several others sort of that got double identification in that list. Now, if you were Episcopalian or Presbyterian or Congregationalist, you might be Episcopalian or Presbyterian or Congregationalist because that was the law of the land at that point in time. Church membership was mandatory, just like citizenship. And so it didn't necessarily mean that you were a strong adherent of that faith tradition. Within the 13 Congregationalists, there were two who even at this early date were identified as having Unitarian sympathies. Among the Episcopalians, there were two who were identified as deists. There were two Quakers, and not identified as such any place else, but found in our archives, because we have the writings, we know there was one Universalist. So, the Unitarians were John Adams and Robert Treat Paine. The deists, who typically did not have churches of their own and so hung out with the Unitarians quite frequently, were Thomas Jefferson and Benjamin Franklin. Benjamin Rush was the Universalist. The group of five that actually drafted the Declaration of Independence included John Adams and Benjamin Franklin and Thomas Jefferson, two deists and a Unitarian, and Christians Roger Sherman and Robert Livingston. Now, this was not a leisurely endeavor. It's hard for us now to imagine the intensity and the whirlwind of activity that were happening in the 13 colonies at that part of time. point in time. There's lots of travel back and forth, lots of correspondence, lots of concern about what to do about their relationship with Great Britain. And there were emissaries and letters sent and attempts at reconciliation and concerns about, well, what do we do if we can't reconcile? How do we set up new governments if there isn't a government because the king has dissolved things? How do we work together to, I mean, what are we going to do? So the ideas that were circulating, the ideas that are present in the Declaration of Independence, were actually all there already, sort of circulating in this whirlwind of correspondence and conversation, and in these many attempts to try to figure out what to do next. But even that doesn't tell us how unique or how intrinsic to the unfolding colonies the ideas in that document are. So Forrest Church has a lovely book. He is a UU minister who served in All Souls in New York. He has a couple of wonderful books. This one is written in 2002. It's called The American Creed, which is what he calls the Declaration of Independence. And he argues in this text that the real roots for the Declaration of Independence go all the way back to the founding of our country, to the Mayflower Compact. And there's one other book I'm going to be drawing on, and I just want to show it to you while I'm standing up here. It's called Our Declaration. It's a close reading of the Declaration of Independence in defense of equality. It's written by Danielle Allen, who is a government professor at Harvard and an African-American woman. She did her close readings with two groups of students, one a group of normal Harvard undergraduates, and the other a group of immigrants and returning adult students who came to the night school course she taught. And she shares in the book how transformative it was for her and both sets of students to read through the Declaration of Independence the way you might read through Shakespeare, a line at a time, parsing it carefully, and how empowered she and her students all were. So I commend that book to you. So Church takes us all the way back to the Mayflower Compact, which is the conversation that the Pilgrims had when they left to come to the United States. And we still use language from the Mayflower Compact. We call it the Pilgrim Covenant, and it's the one we use a couple of times a year that says, we do covenant to walk together in the ways of truth and affection as we know them now or may learn them in the days to come, that we and our children might be fulfilled and that we might speak to the world in words and deeds of peace and goodwill. Well, put the theological language back in and recast it way back when, and the sentiment is the same. And Church suggests that this is something really very new in the world, because while the Mayflower Compact references God and acknowledges the king, it sets up the government as being something this group of people entered into of their own volition. That it was the covenant between the members of the expedition that was the foundation for the government. And Church suggests we see that in two places in the Declaration of Independence. We see that in the stating of the moral and ethical grounds for the agreement in the first part of the document. And we also see it in that sense that governments formed by compact derive their power from terms set by the governed. So it's not that God told them to be a government, and it's not that the king told them to create a government. They agreed with one another that this was what they were going to do. Now, He also identifies the Puritans, our Puritan forebears, as having input into what was generally taken for granted as how you would govern yourselves. And from the Puritan part of our heritage comes this notion of congregational polity. Congregational polity is biblically based in that idea that in God there's no male, no female, no slave, no master, that in God everyone is equal. And so the Puritans, although they didn't practice this at all, preached it. They had this notion that within the church, the elect were all equals. And so that all of them had insights that should be tapped in governing the community. So this is 150 years before the Declaration of Independence. And these ideas started being practiced all over the colonies, this sense that here's a way to govern yourselves that is based on the consent of those governed and that treats every person as equal. So you have 150 years of community experiments on how to live this way happening along that eastern seaboard of the United States, okay? There's a third idea that is very unique that also comes out of this time and gets carried forward into the Declaration of Independence and into what becomes our country, and that's the notion of the separation of church and state, which is why it's ironic to be talking church or talking state in church on Sunday morning. But so there was a Puritan separatist who actually got kicked out of Massachusetts because he was too radically Puritan. His name was Roger Williams, and he later founded Rhode Island and First Providence Plantation and then Rhode Island, and then was in correspondence with William Penn and Ben Franklin around drafting the rules for Pennsylvania. His argument for the separation of church and state was that the first tablet of the Ten Commandments dealt with holy things, what was owed to God, and was therefore appropriately monitored and adjudicated by the church. But the second tablet dealt with the things that we owe our fellow citizens, and therefore the church should have nothing to do with it, and it should be the province of only civil government. And so when he set up Rhode Island and was instrumental in the setting up of Pennsylvania, those ideas based on that notion get translated into the general milieu of how the colonies were functioning and what was being talked about. So,
what do you mean by tablet, first and second tablet?
This is the Ten Commandments were said to have come down on two stone tablets, with 1 through 5 on one and 6, 7, 8, 9, and 10 on the other one. And he thought that that was intentional. That was his argument, that God did this on purpose and we should learn from it. So, when Jefferson and Adams then sat down, now these guys were busy. So it turns out that the very busiest of them was John Adams, of the 5 men who drafted the Declaration of Independence. Adams was the busiest, but he seems to have been a real workhorse. He went from 7 in the morning until 10 or 12 or 2 on a regular basis. He would go visiting his committee members after hours. The session ran until 10 at night, and then he would go and visit people after that. And the other one was Thomas Jefferson. The others were all in and out and back and forth, but Thomas Jefferson had just arrived from Monticello and didn't have a whole lot on his plate yet. And so Adams prevailed upon him, please, to do the first draft. So when they sat down together, they drew both on this history of what was familiar in terms of how their different communities governed themselves and all these ideas that were roiling around in the culture. And what they were supposed to do is weave these together to create a memo of independency. And that's what it is. Memo comes from memorandum, which means something to be remembered. And this was something to be, this document was something that everyone was supposed to remember once they'd seen it. And it needed to do two things. It needed to both justify the colony's separation from Great Britain in a way that would satisfy the rest of the world, the candid world, as they say. But it also needed to do something akin to a wedding ceremony. It actually, in its drafting and signing, had to effect that separation and create the new nation. One of the things that is phenomenal about the Dunlap broadsides of the Declaration of Independence is this is the first time in print that anyone ever saw the name These United States of America. And it is because it was printed and signed and posted on July 4th that that date becomes Independence Day. The war had been going on for over a year. It wouldn't conclude for a long time after. But this date, smack dab in the middle, became the date that we celebrate, partly because that document was effective. So Jefferson and Adams wrote the draft, and in a process that is familiar to anyone who has ever written anything in committee, they then submitted it to the other three for comment. And they revised it, and then they took it to the Congress. Now, the little book out of Harvard that I showed you actually has facsimiles of the edits. The Congress cut the content by almost half. They added all of the God language because two deists and a Unitarian were not going to draft a document which relied heavily on God. So that was added in after the fact, and then they struck the passage that Jefferson and Adams had included that decried slavery and suggested that it should not be permitted in the new nation. And they had to do that in order to create a unanimity among the 13 colonies to have the strength to move forward. But as anyone who has ever watched the crafting of a document in a group of people, it's kind of like making sausage. And it is a testament to the skill of the writers and to the passion that they brought to the project that the document we end up with is something that is beautiful and resonant, not just something that's practical. So the final document has four parts, and I have about one page left, so I'm just going to zip through it here. The final document has four parts. It starts with that justification, the morals and ethics that ground the action. It then submits the proofs of unjust treatment and gives them to an impartial world. It declares the colony's independence. And then finally, it concludes with the pledges of the signers that they are going to put their lives and their livelihoods on the line in order to make this thing come true. The vision that is articulated in that document still fires our imaginations, and it fires the imaginations of people around the world. We return to it, liberals and conservatives alike, every time we need justification for a virtuous project. So, freeing slaves, granting women and people of color full personhood and the right to vote, legislating the right of LGBT people to marry, all of these, when you look at the arguments, go right back to that passage in the Declaration of Independence, which is our culture's DNA. It goes, all of those things grow from we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all are created equal, that they are endowed by their Creator with certain inalienable rights, and among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. The document, the ideas that shaped it, the democratic and participatory processes by which it were crafted are all our inheritance. And I share that with you on this Independence Day weekend, not so that you can go out with your bragging rights and rest on the laurels of your ancestors, but rather because this is a rather contentious election year that we are in the midst of. And we need to remember where we come from and who we are and what we know. We know that values must undergird community action, that what we say and how we say it is important, that the processes of building consensus in a democracy are crucial to the success of any project, that the skills of democracy are nurtured here in our faith communities. The vision cast for this nation in the Declaration of Independence is our civic and our religious inheritance. When we know what our forebears did, we have a sense of what we in turn are capable of, what we can expect of ourselves, and what others might expect of us. This is true for us as individuals, as faith communities, and as nations. What are you going to do to live up to your legacy? We extinguish our chalice flame now, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fires of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. Would you find a way to take hands with someone near you? Lydia, let's us fit in here.
Right.
And would you repeat after me, please? May love and skill be in our hands.
May love and skill be in our hands.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and courage fill our hearts.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love and wisdom light our minds.
May love flow through us and walk among us.
May love flow through us and walk among us.
As we live our lives and help to heal our world.
As we live our lives and help to heal our world.
Amen, shalom, blessed be, namaste, assalamu alaikum. Please turn and greet your neighbors.